this talk is about the Beehive Lab, the Beehive project. Let me clarify, this has nothing to do with bees, so don't get confused. And today we're going to talk about the project and the open source software that is produced through it. So first, what is the Beehive project all about? It's about providing an ecosystem that will allow hardware and software co-design. It will provide a modular, it will be modular and easily extensible. It supports multiple hardware architectures, supports multiple programming languages, supports heterogeneous systems, has realistic and diverse simulation infrastructures, and integrates popular research tools. So, at a high level, this is the overview of the system. It consists of three layers. There is the applications layer, the runtime layer, and the computing platform layer. And in more detail, on the applications layer, we want to be able to support multiple programming languages. So we aim for native language support for C, C++, and Java. And for guest languages like Ruby, R, that we aim to support through the Truffle runtime framework and the Graal compiler. For those not familiar with these terms, Truffle is a, it's a framework for implementing interpreted languages. And Graal is a just-in-time compiler for Java written in Java. Then using Truffle, we might be able to execute LLVM intermediate representation code, which will allow us to execute programming languages that are supported by LLVM. So this makes Beehive capable of running multiple different languages. We want to support multiple benchmark suites like Spec, Parsec, Takapo, etc., all the famous ones. We also want to support computer vision applications like simultaneous localization and mapping, and big data applications and frameworks, MapReduce, Spark, Flink, etc. Regarding the language VMs that we provide in the Beehive project, we have the Maxine VM, which is a state-of-the-art research virtual machine, and the Hotspot VM, which is the de facto production JVM. Both virtual machines share the Truffle runtime framework, so we can run the same programming languages on both VMs. And they share the production quality optimizing compiler, Graal. So in both VMs, we get a very good just-in-time compilation. We want to support hardware acceleration, so we have implemented Indigo, a compiler plugin that allows us to utilize the CMD hardware extensions of CPUs for computer vision applications. And we are able to run Java on GPUs and FPGAs using the Tornado VM. We will see Tornado VM in more detail later. Then, we are still on the runtime layer. We can modify dynamically the binary through Mambo, and we can profile and manage the DVFS. We can dynamically change voltage and frequency using some drivers. Now on the compute layer, regarding hardware, we want to support as many hardware devices as possible. We want to support CPUs, GPUs, DSPs, FPGAs, whatever you can think of. We also support simulation, so instead of running on a real hardware, you can run on a simulator. We currently have integrated Beehive with Gem 5 for accurate power performance and reliability modeling. It's integrated with other well-known tools like MacPad, Hotspot, VoltSpot to get more info out of the simulation. And we also integrate APT Sim, an in-house simulator that is faster but less accurate than Gem 5. To summarize, the Beehive project aims to enable full system code design and exploitation. It's work in progress, so some things we want to achieve, we are not yet there, it's work in progress. And as we move forward, we open source components from the whole stack. So now, today, I'm going to focus on three of these open source parts. First, we will talk about Maxine VM. So Maxine VM, as I previously said, is a state-of-the-art virtual machine. It currently supports Java 8, including lambdas and the invoke dynamic bytecode. It has two-tier just-in-time compilation. It has a fast compiler that produces low-quality optimizations and a little bit slower compiler that produces higher-quality optimizations, so faster code. It has a modular design that allows us to experiment with different algorithms for different parts of the JVM, for instance, different garbage collectors, different compilers, etc. It's OpenJDK compatible, so it uses the same class path as the OpenJDK and the Oracle JDK. It's written in Java, which makes it easier to tweak. It has good IDE support and tool support in general. It currently supports AMD64, ANV7, ARC64, and there is a RISC-V port in progress. There's also MMTK integration in progress. MMTK is a memory management toolkit. It was initially developed for JIXR VM, and it's a nice toolkit that allows you to build garbage collectors without having to re-implement all the basic components. So you can take the components from the MMTK, combine them, and make a new garbage collector with less effort. We are also in the process of integrating the JVM compiler interface. This is a new interface that is going to be integrated in later Java versions. And this allows us to hook different just-in-time compilers on different JVMs. So you can take the compiler of Hotspot and use it on Maxine, or vice versa. And you can have different compilers and run experiments without having to modify the JVM. So a high-level overview of our vision for Maxine. On the top layer, of course, we have the applications. This is Java applications or Ruby, R, whatever is supported by Truffle. Then we have the memory management toolkit. We integrate Truffle and Graal over JVM CI. We plan to keep the two compilers that are currently available in Maxine. We have the monitor scheme, which allows you to experiment with different locking and synchronization mechanisms, and other tools like the layout of the objects. You can change how objects are stored in memory, etc. Maxine also consists of a substrate thin layer, which is actually implemented in C, because we cannot implement everything in Java. We need a thin layer to interact with the operating system. Maxine currently runs on both Mac and Linux. There are the foundations for running on Windows, but we are not supporting this yet. As I previously said, we have support for x86, ARMv7, ARC64, and we're currently working on bringing RISC-V support. Regarding the pass rates of Maxine, it currently has a 100% pass rate on Da Capo and SpecJVM for x86. For ARMv7, the numbers are a bit lower. It's 90 and 60%. And for ARC64, this is a fairly new port. It's 73 and 75%. And we are constantly working on improving these numbers. So next is the Tornado VM. Tornado VM allows us to run Java on hardware accelerators. So you write pure Java, and it runs on GPUs, FPGAs, and CPUs. So how does Tornado work? Tornado relies on an API and some annotations. Its API follows the task-based programming model. And Tornado uses a runtime that's responsible for moving data and performing the synchronization in a completely transparent way to the user. So here we see an example of a code segment written in Tornado. So we have a vector addition here, and we annotate the for loop with the parallel annotation. So this is essentially a hint to the Tornado compiler that this loop can be executed in some hardware accelerator. And then we define a task schedule. We can give names to the task schedule so we can refer to them later in our program. We add a task to the schedule. The task is actually named T0, and it's, it uses the add function for the computation. We say that we want to stream out C. If you see C is the third argument, and the third argument is the one that's being written, so we want to stream out the data. So after the computation is complete, we need to bring it back to the host. And then we invoke execute to actually run the code, the task schedule. So what happens at runtime? The whole program is compiled in Java classes, so nothing special there. Then we load this in a standard JVM, and we start executing. If the standard JVM that we use doesn't have Tornado support, then the program will run sequentially without any issues. If it has Tornado support, then what happens is that when it finds an annotation, a Tornado annotations, it passes this code segment to the Tornado compiler. The Tornado compiler takes the bytecode and creates a data flow graph, analyzes the graph, optimizes it, and produces an internal Tornado bytecode for this code segment. And this is cast. Then when the JVM comes across some Tornado API task schedule execution, it will look for this Tornado internal bytecode, and it will try to execute it. So at this point, we have another VM running inside the VM, which interprets Tornado bytecode. This VM is capable of interpreting Tornado bytecode to migrate tasks across devices. So the task might be running on the CPU, and the VM is capable of migrating to the CPU, or from the CPU to the FPGA. And in this process, it's responsible for moving the data as well and performing any synchronization needed. So how does this work when we choose a GPU? So from when the VM takes a decision about scheduling, and for instance, it picks a CUDA device, what happens in Tornado VM is that we get a compilation from the Tornado internal bytecode to OpenCL. And then we use the OpenCL compilers to translate this code to machine code for the respective device. Of course, there are some limitations on what you can do in OpenCL. For instance, we cannot support exceptions right now. But you can do a lot of work, especially when it comes to pure computation. Here are some examples. So we run on the Intel CPU and on Intel integrated GPU, on an Alatec FPGA, and on an NVIDIA Quadro GPU. We have five applications. And on the y-axis, we have the speedup over the pure sequential Java code. And this is a peak performance of the Java code, so it's been optimized by the just-in-time compiler. And on the x-axis, we have the input size. And we can see that Tornado is able to accelerate these benchmarks by up to thousands of times without the need to write any CUDA kernel or OpenCL kernel. We just wrote pure Java and used annotations in the Tornado API. Next, is the Mambo tool. The Mambo tool is a dynamic binary modification tool. It's dynamic because it performs the modification at runtime, and it's binary because it operates at machine code level. So it's essentially like just-in-time recompilation of native code. And Mambo has a low overhead, as we will see next. So some use cases for Mambo are microarchitectural simulation that you can achieve by modifying code to trigger specific events in a simulator. Cache simulation by modifying loads and stores. Program analysis by instrumenting your code. Debugging, again, by instrumenting your code. And this is good because you can do it without recompiling the code. So you can even use Mambo to debug code that is already in production and you don't want to stop it from running or change it. So you can just go and modify code in specific places that you would like to check without having to actually create a new release or restart the VM with different flags, etc. And it also supports dynamic binary translation. For instance, you can run ARMv7 applications on ARC64. So why Mambo? There are other tools that do dynamic modification, dynamic binary modification. Mambo provides three variations of its API. There is one variation that gives you high performance, but it's a little bit harder to use and requires a good understanding of what you're doing. And it might not be as portable, so if you change the platform, you need to change the API calls. There's a portable version where you can say, for instance, get all stores and change them, and this is portable across different platforms. And there is an API for that's targeted for ease of use. So you just you can do simple stuff with just a few method invocations. Mambo is also the lowest base overhead among the dynamic binary modification tools for ARM right now, and exhibits good performance scaling for multi-threaded applications. So regarding the performance, here we have a table, and we can see that we have two versions of Mambo. There's the optimized one and the baseline one. And the geomin shows that Mambo has significantly lower overhead than the competitors. The competitors are Dynamo, Rio, and Valgrind. And even in the worst case scenario, the optimized Mambo still is the best one. And Mambo baseline is slightly worse than Dynamo, Rio. Regarding performance scaling when you go multi-threaded, we have a plot here that we run different benchmarks in 1, 2, 3, and 4 threads. And it's not very clear by the plot, but if you take the geomean, you will see that it remains close to 30% for the different number of threads. So in some cases, you might not get good scaling, but on the average case, it's stable at 30%. Mambo currently ships with the following plugins. It has a branch count, cache sim that performs cache hierarchy simulation, memory trace, soft div that replaces hardware divisions with software divisions for architectures that do not implement hardware division, and will soon come with a memcheck that detects and reports memory usage errors like buffer overflow. For those interested and might join PACT 2018, there will be a tutorial there. The whole Beehive project, as well as the open source tools, are funded through the EU Horizon 2020 project's ActiCloud Entity2Data, as well as from the EPSRC funded projects Pamela and Dawn. You can find our projects at GitHub, Beehive-Lab. So please feel free to check them out and use them, open any issues, PRs, whatever you feel like. We will be happy to help you. So that summarizes my talk. Thank you very much. If you have any questions.